How do you do? You're about to unfold the story of
the Bride of Frankenstein. She's alive! Alive! A monster created from cadavers out of rifled graves. A tale that sent my blood into icy creeps.
Would you like to hear what happened after that?
We warned you.
You've been warned. Welcome back to Frankenstein Minute, the podcast that dissects the Universal Frankenstein film series minute by minute. I'm Bill Evenson.
And I'm Tom Lang. Welcome to Black Friday, and you join us for minute 47 of Universal's 1935 Bride of Frankenstein.
Wow.
So I actually did minute 47 of the movie Black Friday in honor of it being Black Friday today. So hope that's okay. Man. Hope that doesn't conflict with what you've prepared.
No, I did minute 47 of the movie Friday, starring Ice Cube and I don't know who's in that movie. I probably sound awful because I don't know what I'm talking about.
Well, I have no idea.
I sound awful.
I have no idea what you're talking about either. So.
Yeah, minute 47. What happens in that one? Wait. No, we're going. Oh, you do it. Okay. I'm thrown now.
Yeah, see,
I don't know who does what.
Everything's off. Well, we're down in the crypt below the graveyard. The monster is.
Is this you talking about how we're recording our podcast?
Yes, exactly.
Is this your reference to that?
Stumbled.
We never did reference. People might notice a difference this week and last week.
We're trying something new. Due to the COVID pandemic right now, we're actually recording these remotely. We're doing it via Zoom. So if it sounds weird, blame Zoom. So that's all I got to say about that.
It's true. That's it.
Yep.
So I am in a crypt below the earth.
Oh, monster.
I'm sorry. So he's
stumbled down the stairs into the crypt below and has fallen on top of a balsa wood coffin and busted the top open. And that's where the minute starts, is he's now looking into the coffin.
Yep.
And we see a profile shot of, what looks like a fairly fresh mummy, because she looks like she's in pretty decent shape.
True.
Nothing about her says that she's been there for a while.
Yeah, there's a sign that says freshly dead or something.
Freshly
like
dead.
That.
Yeah.
So then he
kind of passes his hand over the shroud.
Yeah.
He doesn't touch her or touch it. He just sort of gently kind of passes his hand back and forth over her.
It's interesting because this monster in this film is sort of so brutish. I think we've talked about he just looks bigger. He seems to kill a guy by bumping into him in the village earlier. And now it's Boris Karloff's hand passing over this. It's so delicate, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's supposed to be. He's making an emotional connection with the corpse.
Yes, I think given the opportunity, he can be gentle. Mm-hmm. And here's another person that hasn't immediately attacked him. So he kind of plaintively friend.
Well, that's interesting because first thought was he's really embraced the news that Frankenstein made him out of dead bodies and that he's having some kind of connection with a dead body. But the script says, he stumbles in the dark and knocks over one of the coffins. The lid bursts open. The monster looks inside and passes his hand over a dead white face. He does not understand why this figure, which looks like a human, does not move or molest him. And then he says, friend.
Yeah, right.
I think it's notable that the script doesn't say a gender.
I was going to point that out.
But it seems obvious this is a woman.
It's clearly a female.
Yeah. And I also think it's reasonable if you're watching this movie for the first time or you're not, because a lot happens here. I think there's a lot that's actually confusing in this scene, to be honest.
There is a little bit.
Yeah, you might think this is the bride if you're not paying attention.
Well, and I've heard it referred or read it referred to as such.
And I'm sure I thought that when I first
watched it. Well, I think it's a natural assumption, but nothing that happens after this will
makes any sense.
We'll back that up. Yeah, we'll back that up at all.
In fact, there's plenty to
discredit that theory.
Dispute that. It is a strange thing to show a recently deceased young woman in her coffin, given what's about to happen.
Yeah.
But I get it now, and that's not what happened. That ain't her.
No, it ain't.
And if for no other reason, then that isn't Elsa Lange.
Yeah, that's the big thing.
Spoilers.
Spoiler alert. But yeah, that is not the actress that ultimately plays the monster's mate.
Not that that matters either, no. Given what we're going to talk about over the coming weeks.
Right.
It's complicated.
It's very complicated. There are more crosses this time, not crucifixes, on the wall behind him, framed very much in the same manner as at the hermit's hut. But this being a graveyard at a church in a crypt, those make perfect sense as simple set decoration.
Well, not out of character for the hermit to have one either.
No, it's not.
But yes, you're right.
They're not emphasized like they
are. Yeah, not gratuitous.
Although these are not gratuitous. I guess that's a good word.
Thank you. That's it. I'm done.
Yeah. All right. Good night, folks.
All right. So.
All right. See, he's already left.
Dracula Minute. I got to go do Dracula Minute with somebody who gives a shit about that movie.
Well, good luck.
There's a lot of people that love that movie. Okay.
It's really nicely lit, though. We got the moonlight kind of streaming through. Looks like it's streaming through a grate in the ceiling of the crypt.
Yeah, what the hell?
Because you kind of get that crisscross pattern in the lighting.
It is beautiful. Everything about this scene is lit beautifully. And that one in particular is notable to me that there's yet another way for him to be discovered. You know what I mean? These idiots have just he went over the hill. Okay. All right. Uber,
sure.
I guess we'll follow you. This guy seems to know what he's talking
about. You say something, you say bullshit with enough authority, you know, people will buy
it. Is he still president? I think he is.
For a while. I think he's going to think he is into next year, too. But
this beautiful moment between the two corpses. Well, I shouldn't say two corpses.
Well,
one corpse on one end, and one guy who's like six corpses.
Yeah.
This beautiful moment between all these corpses. He's interrupted.
Yep. We hear a clanking, clattering noise at the far end of the crypt, and we cut to a wide shot, and it's a great set. It's a beautiful set. We don't see a lot of it in the first shot because it's dark. It's underground. I've heard or seen it referred to as the similar set from Dracula, the crypt in his castle.
Okay.
The only thing that vaguely resembles it are the vaulted ceilings, but the pillars, nothing looks the same.
No.
And I even compared the two scenes and they don't look the same.
But the only thing I would say is if you told me it was the same set, I'd say, okay.
Lit
completely differently and dressed completely differently.
At first glance, sure, you would think that, but it's not.
No.
And if it were, why then wouldn't they have used it in Dracula's Daughter, which was shot fairly quickly after this?
In a cardboard box.
They actually used the staircase from the watchtower in Dracula's Daughter.
Well, that's right. I think Patreons will know we talked about that in our commentary for the film Dracula's Daughter.
Universal 1936. It's historically important because it's the last Lemley, and actually they were gone by the time it was released.
Yeah.
But it's the last Lemley produced Universal horror.
Yep. Rest
so
in
there
peace.
There we go.
So the thing about that is we then see these gentlemen entering from a great distance.
Yeah.
And it's like a deep focus thing.
Deep,
it looks
deep,
really nice.
Yeah.
And the way it works, at least here, I call it deep focus, and I don't know if that's the right word to use, because you see what's up close, and then you see what's far away, but you don't see everything in between. So is that the same as deep focus, or is that just we put a lot of light in the back?
It is deep focus, because everything is in focus.
That's true.
Unless it's a split diopter where there's...
That's what I was going to say, yeah. Is it like that? But I don't think it's that
I don't
either.
Think so, because there's nothing in the middle ground.
Yeah, right.
I think the camera is just far enough back in this instance. It's a huge soundstage.
Yeah, right.
It's a huge set, so
it's an interesting use of a huge set. So the gentlemen that are entering the scene here, it's our old pal Dr. Pretorius, and first ghoul and second ghoul.
That's right.
Pretorius and the ghouls enter.
They had a brief hit record for a while too.
Pretorius and the ghouls. Yes.
See, now I got to make that.
Oh my god! I'm gonna be like, Tom, where's this week's episode?
Pulling all nighters.
You know how
on
much
this.
Work I have to do. All right, now Pretorius and the ghouls are operating in secret, right?
Yeah. They come down the stairs at the far end of the crypt and open a big clanky iron gate.
Yeah.
But they're creeping around under the cover of darkness for sure.
They are definitely, they seem to be coming down here to, well, we'll see what they're going to do.
Yeah.
But they are operating in secret.
Yeah.
Didn't they just walk by an angry torch-wielding mob outside?
Well,
you say it's a big set.
Yeah.
But it's not like they didn't just walk past the guy going, he went this way. Right?
Well, yeah, maybe. Although the church might have been in between the two.
I suppose.
We don't see the exterior of the church except for one brief moment in a few minutes.
Actually, now I'm just sort of picturing a scene outside where the three of them are headed to do their dirty work here. And then the mob comes and they stop. And then the jackass yells, "You went this way." And they run off over the other side of the hill and they look at each other and go, okay. That worked. Let's go. We're still on.
Yes. So who's the first ghoul?
Well,
it kind of flip-flops in the script versus what's on screen.
Oh, I hadn't noticed that.
Some lines ascribed to one are delivered by the other.
Interesting. Well, I'll say, I'm just looking at my notes to see, for some reason, I'm thrown by your question.
The first ghoul
is Carl.
Carl Glutz, our old friend Carl Glutz.
And it's funny that you say Carl Glutz because, well, I guess this is one of the notes that I had from later because McQueen's commentary points it out here. So let's talk about it. Sure. Dwight Frye's character, Carl, mm-hmm. is actually the combination of three
different characters.
And at this point, I was going to say at least three because I don't, you know, he's just.
I think it is three, yeah.
Number one is Carl, who kills his aunt and uncle. Right. So yeah, that's got to be Carl Glutz.
Yep.
Number two is ghoul number one or first ghoul who's in this scene. And the reason McQueen points it out here as opposed to later when we see the third character, basically, is that it's noteworthy that Carl's got a partner in this scene. I don't know if that's the right word.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're in a relationship, but I it seems like it to me. So that's why I use the term partner.
Yeah.
Anyways, maybe they break up. I don't know, because later in the movie, he's got a completely different partner. And that's sort of a relic? That's not the right word, but it's a remnant,
I think it's a remnant of early script.
And the way I look at that, and I assume the way you look at that, and the way McQueen looks at it is James Whale really liked Dwight Frye.
Yeah.
And so he plugged him into three different characters and called him one
character. Called him one guy. Yeah, I absolutely think that's what happened.
That's why I say at least three, now that I think about
because it. Because the scene with Henry at Pretorius's apartment.
Thank you.
That was also a different character that ended up being Carl that ended up being cut.
Right. So,
but there's a still that one of our listeners pointed out to us of Carl at the door.
Oh, right. Yes, there are stills
of that.
Yeah, I don't know if we talked about that in the podcast. I'm glad we've said it now.
We didn't talk about it because when he posted it, the episode had already aired.
I'll say this, though. That guy could be the same guy that we see the third character later.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, any of this is... it works the way it is. I'm really glad that it went the way it did. We love Carl.
We love Dwight Frye.
Yeah.
Funny because I just saw a movie called The Vampire Bat that was made in 32 or 33, but it's Lionel Atwill, Faye Ray, Melvin Douglas. It was made by Majestic Pictures, but they shot on old Universal sets. So it looks very much like a Universal picture. And there's Dwight Frye playing the creepy, ghoulish character again. They use like the main set for the old dark house and completely redress it.
I was just going to mention the old dark house because when you said Melvin Douglas, and then you say Lionel Atwill, it's like it's all getting stirred up together in a great stew.
It's all coming together, So the second ghoul is Rudy, although he's never referred to as such on screen that I could find.
Yeah, the guy with the obviously fake Irish accent. Where was he born?
He was born in Tipperary, Ireland. So.
Oh, shoot. And what's his name?
His name is Neil Fitzgerald, born the 15th of January, 1892, died the 15th of June, 1982, in Princeton, New Jersey.
Nice. Yep. So here's the thing I know about him, just to interrupt your flow before you get going. It never occurred to me in my life before researching this week's episode that Neil is short for Cornelius. Did you know this?
No,
he was born Cornelius.
Yeah, I did. It had never occurred to me either before this.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, so I looked it up, and I just wanted to give you some other famous
Corneliuses.
There's Cornelius Diamond.
Yeah. No.
I got a whole list.
Yeah, keep going.
Cornelius Pert, Cornelius Sadaka. Cornelius Innes.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course.
Yep.
Cornelius DeGrasse Tyson. Cornelius Armstrong.
Oh, thank you.
Landed on the moon.
That was my high school was named for him.
There you go. Yep. And of course, most famously, Cornelius Before Zod. There you go. I'm done.
See, now it was worth it for the last one.
All right, good.
Totally worth it.
It was a long road.
It was a long way to go.
And I cut out about half
Did
of
you
them.
Really?
I mentioned Cornelius Simon or Cornelius Young or Cornelius Schoen. from Journey.
I do believe that Chevy Chase's real name is Cornelius, though.
Oh, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Cornelius Chase.
I don't know if that's his last name, but...
Probably not. Yeah. Chevy Chase is just a super fake name.
Totally.
Yeah, for a person. For, anyway.
No, it works for a bank. I don't know.
Yeah. Is it really a bank? Yeah. I mean, I'm thinking of the city.
No, but it's a city and a bank, and
It's a bank? Yeah. Chevy Chase Bank? Yep. Wow. Well. All right, so what do we know about Neil Fitzgerald?
Cornelius Fitzgerald. No relation Cornelius to Fitzgerald. Barry Fitzgerald from a bunch of John Ford films.
Or he is no relation?
No relation. Or no relation that I could find to Ella Fitzgerald either.
What about F. Scott?
F. Scott? Nope. That was my next one, and no relation to Zelda either.
Think I'm out of Fitzgerald.
Yep. But speaking of John Ford...
No, Larry Fitzgerald, I believe, is a wide receiver for the Arizona Cardinals.
Sure, why not? I'll take your word for it.
Or was. I've probably combined two guys. One named Larry.
One named Fitzgerald. Best
no relation to Cornelius from
Planet of the Apes, who was known affectionately as Neil by his close friends.
He always will be too.
Yeah, he's Neil. Most famous for his role in The Informer, a John Ford film, which if you haven't seen, you should. We've mentioned it a few times.
We didn't say. Well, I was going to say we didn't mention John Ford a lot. I mentioned him a few times, and I did
say that he collaborated quite a bit with John Ford. So not when we did later, when you said, he's worked with everybody. That was when.
Oh yeah, that's right. I said he worked with everybody, and I didn't mention the most famous guy. But and that's screwed up because I know you mentioned Stagecoach.
I mentioned The Grapes of Wrath. I mentioned quite a few. So
okay.
Other credits. He has 58 of them from 1934 to 1972. So he had a lengthy career.
And a lot of them have the words Bulldog.
Yeah, they do. There's quite a few Bulldog Drummonds. Charlie Chan in Shanghai, Anything Goes.
All right, he's got a couple of those, Charlie Chan.
Couple Charlie Chans, yep. Lost Horizon is a magnificent film.
Yeah.
13th Chair is a nice little thriller. Holiday with Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn. The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. The second...
I was about to say it wrong. It's the one that doesn't have John Carradine in it.
That's right. Yeah. So they replaced the role that John Carradine played in Hounds of the Baskervilles is played by Neil Fitzgerald in The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes.
That doesn't sound right at all.
It's totally not right. Then a lot of TV from 49 on. He was in the film Niagara with Marilyn Monroe and Robert Mitchum. And I think his last film was something called Savages. So I have to let the dog out. I'll be right back.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll vamp. It's Bride of Frankenstein. This is the one that's actually the second film. It's called The Bride of Frankenstein.
Did you vamp while I was gone?
It's me vamping.
Okay. I didn't hear a word you said, so.
You weren't gone long enough. Anyway. Fuck you, Tom. Fuck you.
Yeah, fine.
All right. Then
I'll hear it when I go to edit.
All right. So that's Neil Fitzgerald.
That is Neil Fitzgerald.
Neil Fitzgerald is most famous for the film Bride of Frankenstein. He enters in minute 47, and we'll see how long he sticks around. Is that all you had?
That's basically it, yeah.
All right. You got more?
No.
You said basically.
No, that was it.
All right. Here's the thing that I've always kind of found interesting, and I looked it up, and I asked someone. In the middle of this pandemic, I'll leave it up to our listeners to guess who I asked, someone who was in the house, what is the definition of a ghoul? And you know what? Tom?
Yeah.
What's the definition of a ghoul?
It varies. It's changed quite a bit. In ancient times in the Middle East, it was essentially a ghost or spirit, wasn't it?
Yeah. No, I'm shaking my head. It's because I'm like, the fucker knows the answer. I didn't know that you'd have in ancient times in the Middle East. What are you talking about? Yes. Here's what it is now.
No, now it's become sort of Webster or sort of like a cannibalistic monster or I know, like in my correspondence with George Romero, he never used the word zombie to describe the creatures in his films. They were ghouls.
Interesting. Well, I mean, this, all right, that this sounds pretty good. It's, I can't remember if it was Webster or Oxford. Number one is a legendary, legendary is kind of funny. A legendary evil being that robs graves and feeds on corpses. Okay, so I think we can dismiss
that's
that.
That's a little more of a modern
interpretation. Because here's where I get lost.
Not like 20th century, but just prior
so
to
then
it.
The second one, it says one suggestive of a ghoul.
Yeah.
Which is pretty good. But then it says, especially, : one who shows morbid interest in things considered shocking or repulsive.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so that's probably pretty close.
Yes.
I guess what I think is, I've never quite known what a ghoul is, and I've watched movies like the movie The Ghoul.
The Ghoul.
For example.
with Boris Karloff and Ernest Thesiger, yeah.
Or Ghoulies, if you will. You know, and I've never quite gotten my, I've never known what a ghoul is. And I decided, if you had asked me before, you know, if you'd asked me a month ago, I would have said, well, actually, in my condescending tone, actually, madam, because that's how I speak to women. Sorry. Actually, a ghoul is a grave robber. I convinced myself that a ghoul was a grave robber.
I don't think that's wrong.
Well, here's the thing. In this movie, clearly that's all it is.
That's exactly what it
because
is.
Because this says, the implication of what I've looked up is that a ghoul is someone who has a morbid interest or is in some way, you know, interested in this. And these guys quite definitively aren't.
They're not interested.
Interested at all. The first... well, actually, the first thing they say is,
I can smell the ghosts already.
Can you smell ghosts? Because I don't know about ghosts. I'm not a ghost guy.
I've never got close enough to take a whiff.
No. Well, I mean, you wouldn't know, though, would you? If you're not...
No.
If you don't have the apparatus, if you don't have the machinery. Right.
You don't have the Ghostbusters stuff, yeah.
Well, I mean...
There are actual things you can get that supposedly...
So, here's the thing. Roughly half of our listeners are friends of mine. And so they know that a good friend of mine does this stuff. He has a web series and a podcast and a TV show. And
who's that?
His name's Greg. I don't know if he wants me to plug his stuff. Oh. I might as well. His name's Greg Bakken. And
that fucker.
Yeah. he doesn't listen, I don't think. But he has a show called Ghost Box, or it might be called Minnesota Ghost Box or something. And he goes around and with his little ghost box, and it's like a radio that scans frequencies and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, because BuzzFeed has a series.
Okay.
That these two guys that remind me a lot of the two of us do this stuff, and one of them fervently believes in it, and the other doesn't.
Well, see, that's the thing that I was going to mention is Greg knows me, and he knows that I don't truck with any of this. So
yeah, I don't either. But
he may or may not feel grateful for the plug, but he knows I'm not going to.
You're not going to
believe a word of this shit.
Yeah,
but. I don't know that I'll have to ask Greg if you can smell ghosts.
Yeah, find out because I don't.
Maybe that's part of it.
I think he's just it's just an expression on Rudy's part. He doesn't actually smell ghosts. I think it's like I can already it's more of a facetious thing.
Right.
I've always looked at it as
that makes sense
rather than I physically can really smell a ghost. That
I'll tell you what I think I'm guilty of this sometimes doing this minute by minute. A line or something will strike me and I'll go off on it like that. We've now done about 10 minutes. Pretty obviously just kind of a joke.
Yeah.
Like I can practically smell the ghosts. And although I did, no, he does.
Carl says it, not Rudy. I'm sorry.
Yep, Carl says it because he says in an American accent.
Yeah.
Although I did see recently somebody said that cemeteries are generally not particularly haunted. So I tried to look that up on Google.
Yeah.
Google. And, I couldn't find it anywhere because all I could find was haunted cemeteries. There's tons. A mess.
It's all hogwash. So
then ghoul number two says, I never could stand graves, which is, point number one in my argument.
That these aren't ghouls.
Are not particularly interested in this.
Terribly ghoulish.
And they're not ghoulish. Perfect. Perfect. That's exactly what I'm saying.
Well, and see, when I was a kid, there was a cartoon that was a spinoff of Archie that was the Groovy Ghoulies.
Okay.
And it was, it was Frankenstein monster, Dracula, Wolfman, Mummy. They were silly.
Right.
So ghoulies, it's always been sort of, to me, just sort of a generic monster term or horror term. When I did the horror hosting. I was Uncle Ghoulie, and it just because it sounded funny.
God, that's true.
I didn't do. I didn't
was
do
mentioning
anything.
Different ghouls, and I didn't mention that
yeah,
one.
Thanks well, a then lot.
Yeah, I know. I kind of buried the. Yeah,
which is why Gilbert said I should kill myself.
Is that right?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, well, great. Patreons, be on the alert. Yep. We'll be dropping that one soon if we haven't already. What is today? It's Black Friday.
Black Friday.
We'll see if we have maybe. Maybe that could be
Black Saturday special.
So within this crypt beneath the ground, mm-hmm. there's a particular area that's fenced off.
Yes.
With like a wrought iron fence.
I call it a cage. I don't know what else to call it because, yeah, it's sequestered from the rest of the crypt.
And I think, I can't remember if it's the script or the Dreadstone. It's referred to as a private vault. Mm. Which makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But I mean, I don't know. It also doesn't make sense. I picture a vault being a
closed
actual
in.
Physical.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's funny because it's this big, imposing wrought iron fence is presumably put in place to prevent precisely what's happening
right now. Yes.
And it seems like they have no problem.
Yeah, no, they just
going in there.
Well, it appears as
just opens
it
up.
It appears as though Pretorius has the keys because when you hear them entering in the previous minute.
Okay, that's what the jangling is.
Or no, this beginning of this minute rather. Yeah, you hear the jangling and clattering, and either he's picking the lock or he's got keys from somewhere, and it's Pretorius, okay. So I wouldn't put it past him to have a set of keys.
That makes sense. I like it.
Yeah.
I like that actually quite a bit. They're engaging in a very deliberate act, and the notion of Pretorius having been down here before,
yes,
and being like, yeah, shoot, I gotta get the keys, you know, whatever.
He knows indeed. What he's looking for because they go right to it.
But I guess, yeah, I got to make sure I don't slip into next minute.
Well,
but,
you know, that wouldn't be the first. So you go right ahead.
I don't want to, you know, turn into a cliche.
Okay.
What one thing I really like about this minute, and this is amplified again by me watching it minute by minute.
Sure.
I notice things in a different way than right. they probably really are.
Yeah.
But up until now, there's been very little tying this movie together. Mm-hmm. Minnie has been in the monster parts of the movie and in the Pretorius parts of the movie.
Right.
And the Burgermaster was with Henry briefly. Carl has now entered the Pretorius
side. Floated
around. And in the deleted scenes.
Yep.
But now we finally really have the two movies coming together.
Yep.
And the first thing that happens is the monster stands back in the shadows and watches
the other movie happen. Yeah, exactly.
I think it's really cool. Yeah. I mean, I don't want to make too much of that. I don't really mean that it looks that way. It's just a nice sort of introduction to the fact that that's about it, this grand meeting is about
everything
to happen.
Everything is kind of starting to coalesce. It's like you've seen the movie The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
Yes.
And it's probably like an hour into that film before you even know what the story is about.
I suppose that's true.
All these
it's all character
strands,
stuff.
It's all very character driven, as Leone's films are wont to be. And this always sort of reminds me of that structure where you have all these disparate stories kind of going along that all kind of come together at a certain point.
Now, and in the next, say, couple of weeks, we're going to see how well that comes together. Does that collision of characters pay off? And I think people will already know how we feel.
Yeah, it probably does. Yeah, it's an interesting area because there's like these cool statues on the corners of the fenced area.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's very elaborate. There's an altar in there.
Yeah.
Inside there.
Yeah.
This person, whoever she was.
So don't.
Had.
Well, it's not just person because there's more than one casket in there.
But they're after one specific.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Good point. I see what you mean. This person.
So whoever this family was then, we'll say.
Right.
Obviously had some means
mm-hmm.
that they could have this private area in this massive mausoleum.
I think it's interesting that you say whoever this family is, because we're going to talk about a name next week.
Right.
Anyway, the less said about that, the better.
Yeah.
Is it just me?
Well,
go ahead.
No, go ahead. Right. I was just going to make a lame joke. So
oh, shoot. That's why people listen.
And I forgot it, so never mind. Just go ahead.
All right. Well, speaking of lame, is it just me, or does Pretorius in this minute look like one of Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec's 1893 paintings of Aristide Bruant, the cabaret performer?
I'm sure I'm familiar with it, but just off the top of my head, I can't.
Well, there's a reason why I'm familiar with it. That might make it
make a little more sense.
He's got a big hat and a big scarf and a big black
flowing black cloak
that makes him look tiny inside it.
Yep.
And and in this minute in particular, I think he looks that way.
Yeah.
So now this is where you punch me in the face if we weren't on
Zoom.
On Zoom. The reason that's those pictures are familiar to me is apparently they were an inspiration for the Doctor's outfit in season 18 of Doctor Who. So he's got the scarf.
The Tom Baker.
And the hat, the Tom Baker.
The, the only Doctor Who.
The only one. The only Doctor Who. I'm tempted to go now and grab one because it isn't well, the... Well,
I know exactly what you mean, and I think most everybody listening will know exactly what you mean.
Excellent, because they're all Doctor Who fans.
Yeah, apparently, I think Dino and I are probably the only ones that aren't. So.
I can hear Dino snoring.
Yep.
And Rick. I don't think Rick,
Rick
has
probably
any
not. Yeah, I've tried. I really have.
John Hazard is wrapped. I have no idea if he. I'm just gonna name all our listeners. Barsky knows what I'm talking about.
Barsky
knows.
Yep.
Okay. Read the inscription. What does it say?
Well, what does it say? Because that's where the minute ends.
I think that's
ends.
A perfect ending yep. to the minute. Yep. That's the one I alluded to last
that's
week.
That's what I thought. That's what I thought you meant.
Nice little segue into next week.
So tune in next week, same bat time, same bat podcast, to find out what the inscription does say.
Follow us on Facebook and join the Frankenstein Minute Village
Army
group on Facebook.
Frankenstein Minute Army?
No, we don't have an army.
We have a cool logo for it that Doc Ivan did.
For the army? Oh, that's right. We do have an army logo. That's true.
Yeah.
But the thing is, though, I picture us being a little more slapdash, a little more like
ragtag.
A mob, like torch, little ragtag.
A ragtag bunch of misfits.
Do people wield torches anymore?
I don't know where to even get a torch like that.
You know, the day we're recording this, there are a bunch of people gathering to support our president in his time of need. Are you aware of this?
Yeah.
It's called the Million MAGA March or whatever.
Uh-huh.
So my Twitter feed is full of people.
If more than a couple thousand show up, I'd be surprised, but that's...
The thing is, what I don't see is torch wielding. It's too bad.
No, I'm sure they're toting guns, but probably not torches.
Well, actually, there's been some concern about that because they're going to D.C. and it's not one of those places that you should walk around
toting firearms.
To our international listeners, they may be interested to know that there are many places in the United States where you're not allowed to walk around toting a gun.
That's
for as much as you see that in the media.
Yeah.
We have some places where that's frowned upon.
Yeah, generally not. Not taken too kindly.
We have little pockets in America where that's frowned upon.
Airports. Apparently city halls it's fine, but state capitals apparently it's fine. So.
Yeah, depends on the capital. But
I know I pass a sign every morning going to work that says that you cannot bring firearms into the Minneapolis City Hall. So
and how many bullet holes are in that sign?
Oh, it's riddled.
Do you just go yeehaw
Yosemite Sam.
Yosemite Sam.
Yosemite. Sorry.
Yosemite.
Yosemite.
What was that?
It was our illustrious president not knowing how to pronounce Yosemite.
But it wasn't Yosemite. Was it?
Yeah, it was. He was talking. Oh, okay. He was stumbling his idiotic way through.
Yosemite.
Yosemite. Yeah.
Yosemite, because the people made it into a thing about it. Yeah, all right. Yeah. Whew, we've entered the political part of the discussion.
Yes.
Join us on Patreon where we talk about politics.
That's as good a place as any to call it a day.
Yosemites.